Today's topic is landless laborers, women and children in agriculture. Nobel laureate Amartya Sen in 1981 states that if one person in eight starves regularly in the world, this is seen as the result of his inability to establish entitlement to enough food. The question of the physical availability of the food is not directly involved. The initial focus of the definition of food security was on the volume and stability of food supplies. But in 1983, FAO expanded the concept of food security to include securing the access of vulnerable people to available food supplies. According to the definition of food security in the 1996 World Food Summit, food security exists when all people at all times have physical and economic access to sufficient, safe and nutritious food to meet their dietary needs and food preferences for an active and healthy life. According to Amartya Sen, access to food depends on the entitlement of certain factors, including entitlement to productive assets such as land. Lack of entitlement to land is one of the most frequently cited causes of poverty, with the chronically poor being exposed directly to the various interlocking factors that push them further into poverty. Acute food crisis associated with the constant poverty leads to the prevalence of starvation, which brings multidimensionality in the aspect of food insecurity of the landless people. Coming to landless laborers. An agricultural worker who does not own or rent any land and who earns a living by working on someone else's land are called landless laborers. The small and marginal farmers are endangered by the lack of access to productive resources such as land. Farmers in the rural areas who are the providers of food to the whole nation are deprived from their essential, including food. Due to their lack of access to the necessary resources, their purchasing powers are reduced. They are expelled from their entitlement to productive resources, including land, by many factors comprised of poverty, indebtedness, climatic factors, etc. As they do not have access to necessary financial resources, the hardcore poor farmers often have to sell off their small holdings either to pay off their debts or to persist on their regular expenses. Climate-induced factors are among the most common causes of farmers in the rural areas being landless. According to the UN Food and Agricultural Organization, following categories of people are to be considered as landless: agricultural laborers, households with a little or no land, and non-agricultural households who are engaged in non-farming activities including fishing, craft making, etc., and own little or no land. And third one is other rural households, including peasants practicing shifting cultivations, hunters, and people with similar livelihood. Among the above mentioned categories, the first two categories are partially or fully landless and depend on the wage labor for their subsistence. Landless people are confronted with multidimensional aspects of poverty. The poor who are landless are exposed to various interlocking factors, which are the causes and consequences of poverty and landlessness. In the preliminary report on the agricultural census in 2008, landless households have been considered as those who do not own any type of land. Characteristics of agricultural laborers. Agricultural laborers are scattered. Agricultural labor in India is being widely scattered over 5.6 lakh villages, of which half have population of less than 500 each. And therefore, any question of building an effective organization like that of industrial workers poses overwhelming difficulties. Agricultural laborers are unskilled and lack training. Agricultural laborers, especially in smaller villages away from towns and cities, are generally unskilled workers carrying on agricultural operation in the centuries old traditional wages. Most of them, especially those in the small isolated villages with around 500 populations, may not have even heard of modernization of agriculture. Unorganized sector. Agricultural laborers are not organized like industrial laborers. They are illiterate and ignorant. They live in scattered villages, hence they could not organize in unions. In urban areas, workers could generally organize themselves in unions, and it is convenient for political parties to take interest in trade union activities. This is almost difficult in case of foreign labor. Accordingly, it is difficult for them to bargain with the landowners and secure good wages. Low social status. Most agricultural workers belong to the depressed classes, which have been neglected for ages. The low caste and depressed classes have been socially handicapped, and they had never the courage to assert themselves. They have been like dump-driven cattle. In some parts of India, agricultural laborers are migratory, moving in search of jobs at the time of harvesting. Government measures to improve their lot by legislation have proved ineffective so far due to powerful hold of the rural elite classes in the rural economy. Demand and supply of labor. The number of agricultural laborers being very large and skills they possess being meager, there are generally more than abundant supply of agricultural laborers in relation to demand for them. It is only during the sowing and harvesting seasons that there appears to be near full employment in the case of agricultural laborers. Less bargaining power. Due to all the above mentioned factors, the bargaining power and position of agricultural laborers in India is very weak. In fact, quite a large number of them are in grip of village money lenders, landlords and commission agents. Often the same person functioning in all the three capacities. No wonder the agricultural laborer is the most exploited class of people in India. There are a number of factors responsible for the continuous and enormous increase in the number of agricultural laborers in India. The more important among them are increase in population, decline of cottage industries and handicrafts, eviction of small farmers and tenants from land, uneconomic holdings, increase in indebtedness, spread of the use of money and exchange system, capitalistic agriculture, displacement of means of subsidiary occupations, disintegration of peasantry, breakup of joint family system. Causes for landlessness are zamindari system. Zamindari abolition had some negative aspects. Firstly, a lot of money had to be paid in the form of compensation to the previous zamindars, that is landlords. Secondly, large chunks of land could be retained by zamindars by claiming these as land under personal cultivation. Thirdly, ownership rights were conferred not on the actual cultivator but on the recorded statutory tenant. However, these tenants had a chain of subtenants who were actual tillers and belonged to the vulnerable sections of the society. In addition, the Forest Department became the largest zamindar in the post-independent era. Private forest surrendered by the princely states, large chunks of pastures, common property resources and community forest were transferred to Forest Department. The rights of tribal and forest dwellers were reduced to consciousness and later abolished totally. These lands were given for management with no ownership rights. However, the Forest Department now claims to be holding 23% of land on which barely 9% of forest exist, while the owners or traditional users of the forest are called encroachers. Similarly, huge tracts of land were given for plantations, where even today at least 30 to 40% of land lies unused. Workers in plantations were given no ownership rights to even the house that they had been living in for the past 4 to 5 generations. Industry was also given huge tracts of land. Many of those who depended on these lands for a living were displaced, leaving them with agricultural labor as their only measure of subsistence. Thus, India entered the post-land reforms period in 1960s with little changed except in a few pockets of forward states. Ceiling laws that were enacted later on were so liberal towards landed elements and their implementations were so ineffective that land concentration remained unchanged. The entire implementation was left with corrupt local and land revenue functionaries. Landowners had the option of surrendering the land of their choice. Consequently, they surrendered the worst land, mostly unfit for cultivation. Problems in agricultural unions. Agricultural unions are faced by the following problems when they try to organize their members. Stagnation in agriculture has meant that workers face joblessness and are forced to migrate, resulting in empty villages. It becomes very difficult for unions to organize workers who are absent for long periods from their villages and who also do not have fixed places of employment. The employer-employee relationship is not always clearly identifiable. Workers work for multiple employers and for short periods of time with each employer, making it difficult to organize. Organizing across regions and states is difficult because the levels of development from one region to another are different and therefore people's objective situations differ. This becomes especially tough when we talk about a national level federation. Acts and rules for registration of trade unions are not suitable for agricultural workers because they are designed primarily with industrial factory based workers in mind. There is also resistance from bureaucracy making registration of trade unions problematic. Agricultural workers live a hand-to-mouth existence, making it difficult for them to struggle in a sustained manner. They are often not able to meet the costs of running the union through their membership fees, creating a need for external subsidies. Demands of agricultural unions. They oppose the establishment of special economic zones and the use of agricultural and village lands for industry, mining or mega projects. In addition, the use of the excuse land is degraded for allotment of land for all the above purposes. They oppose the increasing paperization of agricultural workers through phenomenon such as corporate farming in agriculture. They also oppose reverse land reform that allows market forces to take over the land market with large farmers and the corporate sector taking over land from small and marginal farmers. Measures to diminish landlessness. The land must belong to only those who earn a living from working on that land. Lands must be redistributed with special emphasis on equal ownership rights for women, and that land redistribution be a central issue in the political agenda of the central and state government. The land rights are seen as a livelihood resource and not as a property with collective ownership to ensure the continuity of possession of the land by the landless and the poor peasants. Land earmarked for distribution to backward categories not be given to other groups. The control of common property and natural resources and irrigation water is in the hands of agricultural workers. Full rights to forest land and forest produce are extended to forest dwellers, and that there be community management of forest resources. The right to homestead land is an integral part of agrarian reforms. The compulsory consultation with agricultural workers in matters that relate to their working condition and to agricultural policy in general. Social security identity cards be given to all agricultural workers. There is a need for central comprehensive legislation for agricultural workers with special emphasis on regulation of employment and labor rights, including social security. The qualitative equal educational facility for agricultural workers' children must be ensured. There should be a uniform national living wages that ensures a standard and honorable living for agricultural workers that is at par with other sections of society, and that workers are paid enough for 6 days of work to enjoy a paid weekly holiday. Equal remuneration for equal work, irrespective of gender, caste, creed, race, religion, and community, must be paid. Government must give guarantee of minimum working days for the agricultural labor force. There should be special measures for women workers, such as maternity benefits, crutches, and protection from sexual harassment. Unpaid domestic labor must also be recognized for its economic contributions. They should get essential commodities at subsidized rates by the state. Improved credit facilities by the state meet emergency consumption needs of agricultural workers, and appropriate credit and technical support for the poor and landless peasants for sustainable agriculture should be ensured. Coming to women in agriculture. Women constitute half of the agricultural labor force in low-income countries. For rural women, land is perhaps the most important household asset to support their families and provide food, nutrition, and income security. Agriculture in India defines familial tradition, social relations, and gender roles. Female in agriculture sector, whether through traditional means or industrial, for subsistence or as an agricultural laborer, represents a momentous demographic growth. Agriculture is directly tied to issues such as economic independence, decision-making abilities, agency, and access to education and health services, and this manner has created externalities such as poverty and marginalization and compounded issues of gender inequality. Of the 126 million female main workers in India in 2001, as many as 50 million or 40% were agricultural workers. Not only that, wage work in agriculture is becoming an occupation of greater importance for women. From 1993 to 94 to 1999 to 2000, the number of women agriculture workers increased from 22.5 million to 29.3 million, or from 35% of all agriculture workers to 37%. Male agriculture workers during the same period reduced from 62% to 61%. In the state like Punjab, after the so-called land reform period, women agriculture workers have increased by more than 300 times. In the state of Kerala too, where the most radical land reform took place, while male agriculture workers grew at a steady rate, female agriculture workers grew at twice this rate. An important reason for women's low status is that her work is identified as being unproductive. In agriculture especially, this is a myth. As much of the work that women do as unpaid domestic work often makes the difference between survival and starvation for poor agriculture worker families. Thus, women are engaged in paddy processing and animal husbandry within the household without these being recognized as wage work. Similarly, women may be involved in non-economic activities like catching fish from canals, collecting of wild fruits, leaves and vegetables, and gleaning of grains to supplement the family's food. At the low wage paid for agricultural work, all these activities contribute to the household's survival. If an economic value was put to this work, it would probably amount to more than the wages earned by male members of the family. Women suffer more from poverty even within their own class, as they have no economic or political power at home and in the public sphere. A study by Sanjay Basu Mulik in Jharkhand has shown that places where women had greater control over production and forest resources had higher gender ratios, thus showing that there is a direct correlation between women's survival and their control of productive resources. Coming to child labor in agriculture. In many countries, child labor is mainly an agriculture issue. Worldwide, 60% of all child laborers in the age group 5 to 17 years work in agriculture, including farming, fishing, aquaculture, forestry, and livestock. This amounts to over 129 million girls and boys. The majority of child laborers are unpaid family members. In agriculture, this percentage is higher and is combined with very early entry into work, sometimes between 5 and 7 years of age. Agriculture is one of the three most dangerous sectors in terms of work-related fatalities, non-fatal accidents, and occupational diseases. About 59% of all children in hazardous work aged 5 to 17 years are in agriculture. Causes for child labor. Poverty is the main cause of child labor in agriculture, together with limited access to quality education, inadequate agricultural technology, and access to adult labor, high hazards and risks, and traditional attitudes towards children's participation. Children's participation in agricultural activities, especially in the context of family farming, small-scale fisheries, and livestock husbandry, some participation of children in non-hazardous activities can be positive as it contributes to the intergenerational transfer of skills and children's food security. It is important to distinguish between light duties, that do no harm to the child and child labor, which is work that interferes with compulsory schooling and damages health and personal development. Based on hours and conditions of work, child's age, activities performed and hazards involved. The International Labour Organization defines child labour as work that deprives children of their childhood, their potential and their dignity, and that is harmful to physical and mental development. This refers to work that is mentally, physically, socially or morally dangerous and harmful to children and interferes with their schooling by depriving them of the opportunity to attend school, obliging them to leave school prematurely or requiring them to attempt to combine school attendance with excessively long and heavy work. The ILO current reports note that there are 215 million children worldwide engaged in child labor. Child farm workers often fall under three types of cases. First one, those who work on their parents' farm. Second, those who work on local farms part-time or during the summer to earn extra money. And third one, those who feel compelled to work out of economic necessity, often migrating alone or with their families from farm to farm. Risks and effects on child laborers. The nature of agricultural work exposes child laborers to many risks and dangers, many attributed to the following types of work or conditions. Working with heavy machinery, equipment and tools such as knives, chainsaws, tall ladders and tractors or trucks. Repetitive motion injuries that results from bending at the waist, kneeling, reaching and holding ergonomically uncomfortable positions, and pressure to work fast without breaks and despite injuries. Coming to significance, the socio-economic status of the landless farmers in the rural areas is terrible, characterized by lack of access to basic requirements including adequate food. It has been seen that there is lack of physical and social purchasing power of the small farmers in the rural areas. The landless farmers and their families have very low level of income, which is susceptible to natural catastrophes and man-made hazards. Measures of distress management are not sufficient to act as safeguard measures for farmers against distress. The country has managed to achieve considerable success in augmenting domestic production, but effective management and maintenance of the prevailing food stocks is essential. Moreover, as the small and marginal landless farmers are most susceptible to internal and external shocks, their inclusion in the policies and researchers is crucial. Undertaking short-run measures would increase the accessibility of the poor to the necessary food, but it is necessary to adopt long-run measures to ensure their accessibility to adequate food and healthy life. We can summarize like this: landlessness has increased in the post-independent era, particularly amongst the socially exploited groups. Needless to say, almost all women agricultural workers continue to be landless. Land, however, remains a central demand for agricultural workers, as this would give workers an asset base from which to raise their demands for higher wages and better working conditions. There is also the need to question the whole method by which minimum wages are determined. The Constitution talks about the living wage in Article 43 and not about minimum wage. The Supreme Court has also given order saying that minimum wage should include housing, cost of education, health care, social security, etc. A living wage also implies that workers should receive these wages for an 8-hour working day and should receive sufficient money to allow them a weekly holiday after working for 6 days. However, in actuality, agricultural workers work for meager amount for long hours that start with the rise of the sun and stops only at the sunset. Thank you.